All right, the hangout is on the air and live. Hi, Julia.
Hi, Aya. How are you doing?
Just fine.
So there's been a lot of things going on this week, like over there?
Over on my side?
Yeah, have you guys been busy doing things?
Yeah, well, Bo has been really enjoying the weather, and I put his hammock up.
Ooh.
He was swinging in it, and he shared it with me. Both of us were able to fit on it, and it's very strong.
That's really strong. Like if two
shared it with me,
yeah, people can fit in it. Wow, that's. I haven't been on a hammock in years. That's pretty neat.
Yeah, I think I should probably try to share also. So I see that's what you're doing.
Yeah, that's what I was trying to do. I was just like, so. Anyway, I was going to tag you when I do that. So, yeah, we were going to talk a little bit about a book that I think you have written another book recently.
Yeah, just hold on a moment because I want to share this on my Twitter.
Okay, go ahead.
A certain person can.
Written another book recently.
There you go. There. See what I'm doing here? And I am just going to share that. On Twitter.
Okay, great. Some reason, oh, there we go. Thing is, it's getting harder. This is one thing I don't like. I feel like they're making it harder to tag for me on Facebook. Are you having that same difficulty lately, by the way?
Yeah, I have to actually go down and do the tagging separately. It doesn't happen automatically.
I feel like they're doing that on purpose because I don't know, like, this is just my thought. Are they doing that because they want to discourage, like, people, I don't know, like, from sharing things that are not, like, a main, like, I don't know.
Some people overshare and then other people undershare. So, yeah.
I don't know. But to me, it feels like, okay, I see the same things, like, okay. Not that I go on Facebook all the time, because sometimes I'll look at it and I'll think I responded to a message and I've been really bad at it this week. But when I do go on Facebook, I see like the same kind of meme a lot. Mm-hmm. I feel like. I don't know.
Yeah. No, I mean, even people who have chimpanzees are copying the videos of people who are obviously, they just got the video of a chimp from someplace. You know, I noticed that. It's kind of like there's some site that keeps saying it would help us a lot if you shared our video and also commented on it. And they obviously got these videos from someplace. They're not the people who shot them.
No, definitely not. And this is another thing that bothers me, too, is like, why is it? And I know I've said this again and again. I sound like a broken record. But why is it that people are on Facebook, supposedly they care about what their friends are doing, but that only pertains to, oh, did you post like a picture at a party? But like, let's say your friend's a blogger. Like some people will look at it, but some people won't even look at it if you like share something that you create yourself. But yeah. If I post a picture, just like one picture, it gets more likes than anything I ever post. And it's just like, okay, I don't get it, but never mind.
Yeah. Well, I mean, obviously, the pictures with my daughter are the ones that are most popular because other people have daughters, too.
Yeah, that makes sense. It's like a commonality. I totally get that. I understand people like to look at pictures, but I guess because it just goes back to this thing. I joined Facebook because, hey, it was a great way to promote your blog. Now, like, people are, like, they share a lot of mainstream, like, vlogs or Instagrams of just, like, fame or things that other people created. And I don't know. Like, a lot of it is, like, by the way, on Instagram, a lot of things that are really popular right now, they were saying, like, our recycled content from other channels that people just splice together to get a lot of followers.
Right. Yeah. I mean, somebody that I know posted something about garlic Coke. You know, Coca-Cola with garlic in it. And somebody asked them, well, where can I get that? Because I want to get it to put in the stockings of my children for Christmas.
No. Okay, you know what? I'll get it for you. I'll go buy some Coca-Cola and I'll put some garlic and I'll put it in there for you. I like garlic, but that's another kind of weird. I'm sorry. Why?
But then it turned out he didn't even have the garlic Coke. It was the picture that he copied from someplace else. He had no idea where to get it.
Oh, okay. I could make it for him. If he really wants to try it, I'll make it for him. No, that's gross. I'm sorry. Why? I don't even know why.
But that is what gets responses. You know, if that same person was really talking about liberty, that got a lot fewer responses.
Which is sad because we are losing our civil liberties. It seems like they're censoring more people now. Like, we might not like everything that people say, but the more that they censor, like, when will they say, what if they say like a year from now, like, oh, you question like a certain foreign policy, and they say, well, you can't talk about that anymore because it's questioning, I don't know, they're taking more of our civil liberties away.
Yeah, they certainly are. And we're not doing anything about that because we're too interested in different flavors of Coke.
That's weird. And I did see you posted something about, okay, and I was with my friend that night. They were talking about it on the news, and I thought this was a little ridiculous, where like they basically busted down someone's door because the child was sick and didn't show up at the emergency room. That was surprising to me.
It was actually the doctor told them that if the fever was over 105, they should go to the hospital. But then the fever broke and the child was fine. You know, that happens, right? So yep. Obviously they didn't take him to the hospital because that was not necessary.
No.
So for some reason, the police were informed, number one, that they were told to take their child to the hospital. Number two, that they didn't take the child to the hospital. And so, no, it's crazy. So they got a warrant to break into their house, and somebody could have died, you know?
Yes. And what about the kids? I was just thinking, because I didn't have time to read much about it, I just saw a little news clip. What if that scared the kids, like, for life because of that, the overreaction to, like, somebody not following medical advice? Which is what doctor's medical advice only, and the fever broke, so why? So weird.
Yeah. Yeah. And then there were other people, and some of them were liberty people, and they were saying, well, everybody was at fault. The parents should have called the doctor and told the doctor their child didn't have a fever. That's so weird, because I was told not to call the doctor if it wasn't a really big emergency. I wasn't supposed to tie up the line saying, hey, my child is healthy.
And another thing too, even doctors and other medical officials have said some people go to the doctor too much, and like sometimes you can't, if it's just like a cold, like it's almost worse to go to the hospital and wait hours just to get cold medicine. Or even if you do have the fever, sometimes you should just wait it out. And I've heard various opinions. I don't understand why it had to be so extreme in this case, but I think that's a horrible, gross overstepping of liberty. Like, it's just scary to me that happened.
Right. Yeah. I mean, parents should be able to tell a doctor something and get some advice and then, you know, follow up in the way that they feel is best for their child, because it's their child.
Yeah, it's their children. It's almost like they were trying to make it seem like these parents, they mentioned something about the child being sick in bed, but if a child's sick, sometimes it might throw up. Or what if they were scared because the door was beaten down? Like, we don't know all the, I just hate that they were trying to make this family look bad when maybe the family just decided it was best for them not to go back to the doctor because it,
yeah. You have to remember that way back when I was a child, the doctor came to you. You weren't expected to go anywhere when you were sick.
No, you weren't. And here's another case where it wasn't a child, but there was this lady. She says, I can't move my legs. And they kept telling her at the hospital that she was making it up and she had to leave and she didn't really have an illness. And she's like, my legs, like they feel numb. I can't move them. So the police came and got her and they arrested her and they kept telling her, you have to get out of the wheelchair. You have to move. And she's like, I can't move my legs. And they put her in jail and she died like a couple hours later in her cell.
Wow.
She died because she kept telling them, I don't feel good. There's something wrong with me. But they kept saying in the hospital, she's making this up. And they arrested her and she died in jail a couple hours later. So maybe we shouldn't overreact. Like,
yeah,
these cases just concern me. That's all. You know, it's a random thing I saw. I was just curious, like, what happened.
Well, people should be able to decide for themselves whether they want to seek medical help or not. And they should be able to ask for advice and they don't have to take that advice.
Yeah.
Decide.
Yeah. I think you have a right as a family. Like if you, it is concerning too, because I know some people are more into holistic medicine and maybe they don't want to go be part of West, like what if you were into Chinese, like traditional, are they going to decide, oh, well, that's not sanctioned by Western medicine. Like what's the next thing that's going to happen? You know, I don't know.
They actually went to a regular doctor and they asked for some advice. Okay. Yeah. You're allowed to do that. You're allowed to ask for advice of a medical professional. And you're allowed to ask for a second opinion or to think about it.
I guess not to go too far off on it, but there was another case where the son, he was in his teens, and the mom, they told him he needed to receive chemotherapy, but he didn't want to. Like, he wanted to try, because he felt he was old enough, he was a teenager, to pursue more holistic routes of trying to deal with the cancer. And they said that they were going to take him away from his parents. So him and his mom actually felt like they had to leave the state because of this in another situation.
Yeah.
I don't know. Anyway, not to go off on that, but I just wanted to mention that because I saw all this going on.
Yeah. Well, I think that people should be able to decide for themselves and parents should be able to decide for their children, because you know what? Nobody knows for sure what the right thing is to do. So if you're going to be taking a risk one way or the other, you, the patient or the parent, should be making that decision about risk taking.
Yeah, for sure. I totally think that's common sense.
Yeah.
But anyway, I didn't want to, what else was it?
I was going to tell you a little bit about Sword Chooses.
Mm-hmm.
It came out this week. It's a long story. I mean, it's a short story. It's a little poem, actually. But the long story is about how hard it is since they changed Create Space and everything else. So the only thing that came out this week was the Kindle version of it. It's only 99 cents. This is a poem in two languages. It's Sword Chooses, Cheret Bucheret. But because they took away my ability to publish on CreateSpace, and Kindle doesn't allow Hebrew, we're not telling the public that there's any Hebrew in it.
Okay. Well, why does you only allow English or something? I don't get it.
No. There are several languages it allows, which I think include French and German and a few other Spanish. But Hebrew is not included.
Okay. That's weird, but whatever. I'm sure there's I won't ask why. Never mind. We just won't.
Okay. So when I formatted it, instead of using, you know, actual characters, what I did was I turned it all into a picture. So it's all image, so that anybody who might be looking for Hebrew and hates Hebrew, you know, using a computer, will not be able to tell that there's Hebrew in it. Anyway, I hope that.
Good. That's perfect.
Right. So if you look at the pages in Kindle, it looks like the photo, and it's got words in English and Hebrew on the photo, and they are in verse, and they rhyme and scan.
Ah, cool. That's pretty neat. Did you want me to share the link to, like, in the live share?
You might want to just show them where they could go to buy it. It's only 99¢.
Yeah, that's what I was. So I'm gonna make sure I have this closed up because I have some that one window up. I don't want that up. I'm just gonna put myself into live share for a second. Here I go. I always feel like I'm falling down the rabbit hole or something when I go into this thing. Like now, something really weird is happening. Can you see me sharing?
Yeah, I can see you.
Okay. All right. Now, do you see the screen with sword?
No, not yet.
Okay. Something. Let me try again. I did something wrong. I thought I did it right. Okay. I always do it right. I don't understand. Something's going weird with this. Okay. Chrome wants to share your entire screen. Choose what you want. I want the entire screen. Chrome's just
okay.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, you did it.
Now, okay.
Yeah.
Go ahead. What were you going to say?
That's good. You keep talking because otherwise they'll see me.
Okay. Sora chooses the Kindle edition. So what I did was I'm showing you what it looks like on Amazon. You can buy a Kindle book, buy now with one click. But if you think that it's too hard to do it this way, what you could do is you could just go to Amazon.com. And you could just type in sword chooses. I just want to see.
If you don't write by Aya Katz, you're going to see a lot of pictures of swords.
Got it. That's cool. I'm surprised though. Okay. Sometimes it doesn't, but this time it actually did. It actually came up. Like, that's pretty good though. Wow.
Yeah.
Funny question though. Do you talk at all about like how her name rhymes with sword? Like I know that sounds kind of cheesy, but that would be kind of cool.
Well, yeah, her name is Sword, and it is just like the weapon. So
oh, it is. Okay, I wasn't sure about that. I just was verifying because
and the word cherev here, that's her name in Hebrew.
Oh, that's
sword.
So like, just I'll take it out of screen share so it's not
okay.
Okay, so I have like a question, like in Hebrew, does she go by that Hebrew name? Like when you guys are talking, is that what you call her?
Or yes.
That's cool.
Yeah, so sword is her name in English, and her Hebrew name is cherev. That means sword. And the same thing with bow. Bow's name in English is the much more ancient weapon, you know, the bow and arrow, bow. Yeah. And it's keshet in Hebrew. The word keshet in Hebrew, it can be either a rainbow or a bow and arrow kind of bow.
I thought I had heard you say that before on videos when you're speaking in Hebrew. So you're saying his name, right?
Yes.
Okay, that's cool because I don't speak Hebrew. So I like to learn just like a little bit about each language because I'm not I don't have a large aptitude with languages. I feel like, well, you have to study, but I like to learn little things. So that's pretty cool.
Yeah. And I can read you from the beginning. Well, I can say it by heart because I know it.
Well, yeah, go ahead.
So it starts out, sword has a hat and a nose. It's right there. Sword has a sock and a scruffy old bear.
Aww.
And sword gets to choose right there on the spot. The things she will use of the things she has got.
I like it. I think this is going to be a good, so it's going to start out on Kindle, right? And you're thinking in the future you may do a print version of it?
Yes. And before even the print version comes out, Kelly Clear is working on an Audible version.
Oh, nice. So he's going to say all the Hebrew words, too. This will be kind of fun.
I'm saying the Hebrew words, but
I don't know if
they sound good.
I don't know.
So he's going to be the sound engineer on my Hebrew version. Would you like me to say the first two verses in Hebrew, too?
Yes, I do. I want to hear it.
Okay, and then you can tell me if you think it sounds like it scans the same way. Okay? L'cherev yesh kova, l'cherev yesh af. L'cherev yesh gerev, v'dov meshufshaf. וחרב בוחרת מכל מה שיש, ואז היא אומרת, במה נשתמש.
Yeah, I get, it sounds good. Like, I don't speak Hebrew, but it sounds good.
Well, it basically rhymes and scans the same way. Now, when you translate, I actually wrote the Hebrew one first. Mm-hmm. And if we were in Taiwan when I wrote it.
Oh, nice.
And she was a baby. And then I thought, wouldn't it be nice to also have an English version? So I translated my Hebrew poem into English. And then I asked somebody if they could translate it to Chinese.
Ooh. But
they couldn't figure out how to do it. So, you know, so it would be have the same kind of sound to it.
It might have taken like being there longer, like to find the right person. But did it take like a longer amount of time to get it to scan in English, like to take the Hebrew and make it work in English? Or was it pretty quick, would you say?
Well, it's pretty quick because I write verse and I've been doing that all my life.
Yeah, so. You do it. You're pretty good at it. I don't write verse, but I love listening to it. It's pretty interesting.
Well, that's good enough. I mean, I'm kind of afraid there might not be enough people in the world who enjoy listening to verse anymore. What with, you know, I mean, it used to be everybody liked it. But somewhere between the 19th century and the 20th century, people started being against, you know, scansion. And some people thought it, you know, verse that actually scans is too sing-songy. That's what they called it.
Why?
I don't know. But that happened, you know, that
maybe
really.
If you can bring it back on Instagram, maybe you can do like scan, like ran. I don't know. Like you can think of a hashtag that'll make it all like the hipsters will be like, what is this? And maybe we'll.
The thing is, it really, your entire body goes with it. So when I was this week, I was reading that to Bo. And I was exaggerating. I was actually making it very sing-songy so he could hear the meter. And
yeah.
He said, you know, he started bouncing to it, you know, and he was like, he's got that. He can understand it.
Yeah. So, yeah, I think maybe you can rekindle some interest in it is what I'm thinking. Like on Instagram, like think of a hashtag to kind of bring this niche audience to it is what I'm just trying to think about, like how we can get more people to want to.
Well, I have a slogan, but I don't know if it makes any sense. But I put it on my, the last video that I put on Instagram. I think I did that. Anyway, it's meter matters.
Oh, meter matters.
Yeah.
It kind of reminds me of like meter maids, meter matters. I like it. Huh,
that's
cool.
Yeah, so maybe I'll try to do a campaign that way.
Yeah, maybe you could do use the hashtag every other day or something with something that ties into the book, like if you're posting something that might relate to the book. Just a thought.
Right. Yeah, I mean, it doesn't have to just be about the book. I have like the Rudyard Kipling Facebook page, and it's not all my poetry. It's Kipling's poetry, but his poetry definitely scans. It definitely has meter.
Yeah, it definitely does. I remember when I was in fourth grade, they made us recite the poem If.
Yeah.
That's not my favorite poem, but yeah.
It's not mine either.
God, I'm like, if this will ever end, I remember thinking that.
Yeah.
I like some of his other writing, Ricky Tiki Tavi. I like Ricky Tiki Tavi.
Yeah. Yes, I like it too. Yeah, if is the one that everybody who doesn't know any other Kipling poem, they will mention that one or they will recite that one. But it is not my favorite either.
Our teacher made us, and I think everybody really hated the poem and had a great hatred for it. I don't know if you could ever make a group of people not like a poem. I think making them, like, we couldn't even pick. We all had to recite it. I thought that was kind of strange, by the way, but whatever.
Yeah, they should have asked you to pick one of your favorites to recite.
Yeah, see, that would make more sense, but it's kind of like these group projects where everybody has to do the same thing, and then we're all being compared by the same thing, doing the same thing.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think that takes away the individuality of the project. But anyway, what else would you like to share about the book, just out of curiosity?
Well, I mean, it's basically about how a person coming into the world, it, in most of these pictures, Sword is about a year old, you know. And, you know, coming into the world, you don't have a lot of control at first, but you get to choose little by little what you do with what you've got. And that's what life is all about.
Making choices, and you take ownership of those choices. And
yeah,
it seems like a great children's book for people that might be learning in both Hebrew and English.
Well, I think it's just fun to read. If you've got a baby, you can read it to the baby. And even if the baby doesn't understand all the words, you know, the meter will push things along. And then when you've got a toddler, the toddler can start to learn to read by memorizing the poem first and then leafing through it and learning which word goes with which spoken word.
So, in case there is a Fox, the Hebrew English version, that's on Kindle too, right?
No, I don't think it is. I mean, there's an Audible version of In Case There's a Fox.
Yes, that's true.
And it's read by Patrick Kahn.
And yeah, it's very good.
Yes, it is. He has a wonderful voice. And then the Hebrew English version, I don't believe it is on Kindle. And it really couldn't be unless I turned it all into just pictures.
Maybe you should. Maybe this is a good workaround. I want to be honest with you. I'm so glad you sent me the second version of In Case There's a Fox, because I kind of made a mistake. I sent it to the first version you sent me years ago to a teacher, and she told me she would share it with another teacher and they would review it. And I never heard back about it at all. And I don't know why. She never said anything to me again about it, not once. And I was like, that's interesting.
Well, I sent it to a preschool teacher in Israel, the one that's, you know, in Hebrew and English. And she said it was very nice, but she couldn't read it to the children because they were too young. Oh. And I thought that was, I don't know, I think you can read it to any age child, because you can start at whatever age. They don't have to understand everything.
No, they don't. And I actually kind of think that's where we run into the problems, where there are kids in kindergarten and they can read at a higher level, but they're forced to be doing these assignments that are too boring for them, or ones that need that the emphasis on words. I thought it was a great story, and I think it's suitable for young children. So that's just my opinion. My mom really liked it too, and I like the shirt that goes with it. That's one of our favorite stories. So.
Oh, okay.
You love In Case There's a Fox, just saying.
So, I don't know. I am going to try, when I'm in Israel, I'm going to try to share the book with preschool and kindergarten teachers and see if I can get any of them to read the book to their students.
Maybe you will have a lot of luck because you will be traveling for a bit and you'll meet different people. You know, I'm sure you'll interact with somebody who's interested. That's what I think. So that's exciting.
Yeah. So, you know, so this is my fourth children's book out. If you count When Sword Met Bow, and In Case There's a Fox, and Ping and the Snarkly People.
We like Ping too, so Ping's a good one. And is Ping also on Kindle?
Yes, it is now.
Okay, see, I think this is good. Everybody, you guys can check out Aya's books on Kindle.
Right. And if you like books that are printed, there are plenty of those too.
Yeah, I like the print versions, but I'm just throwing out there, since this one's on Kindle, there's other Kindle versions. So,
right. Oh. Yeah, exactly. So, and here's a thing for those of you who are just bow fans, and you just want to help out, you can read When Sword Met Bow, and Bow is in that one. And you can buy it on Kindle. It's the least expensive that way. And you can buy the Audible version, read by Kelly Clear. And, you know, it helps. Every little bit helps. And what also helps is after you bought it and read it, hopefully you can post a positive review, because that helps.
Yeah, for sure. And I actually think a lot of Bo fans would really like When Bo Met Sword because of all the cute baby pictures of Bo. I mean, Sword's cute, of course, as well, but Bo's a baby. Come on. If you love Bo, like, you can buy this book. Like, it's on Kindle. It's in print version. Go just check it out, you know? If you're really into Bo, you'll check it out.
And I actually could use a few more positive reviews on that one, because there are people who have never read the book and just, you know, go in because they don't like the fact that Bo is the chimp and he was part of a human family, and they just, you know, vote it down.
That's kind of silly. Plus, I thought Amazon changed it, though, where you actually have to buy the book and those reviews are ranked first now. I haven't been on it for a while.
I don't know, but that the negative reviews stay no matter what.
It's kind of disappointing. But anyway, I think more people will discover your books. And, you know, When Sword Met Bo is perfect for anybody who's a Bo fan. So, guys, come on. He was so cute. You have to check it out.
Right. Yeah, definitely. So you read a book recently.
I read more of the book, The Wind in My Hair. So I kind of finally finished it. And I really like the overall message. Okay, I think in general, Mashi Alanjad, she tends to be more from the liberal perspective, which I don't really think that's the way that it has to be. Like, I don't think that you have to be a liberal to expose, like, the fact that there's bigotry in certain cultures. Like, let's be real. Like, okay, so the part about the book that I thought was good was towards the end when she was saying, well, supposedly there were these politicians that were feminists, but when they went to Iran, they never questioned the Iranian government on making all women having to wear the headscarf. Like, in the West, like, they very much stick up for Muslim women, like, well, there was that ban in 2016 where they said, oh, Muslim women can't wear, like, the burkini on the beach. And everybody was, like, up in arms about that. However, like Alanjad said, how come nobody ever says anything to the Iranian government about, well, you know, most women don't want to wear the headscarf. And even, like, some of the more moderate politicians in Iran would say, well, wearing a headscarf is part of our culture, but they were saying that's not true, because if you look at pictures of women in Tehran, they barely cover their hair as much as they only cover it because they have to, many of them, and they don't like having this imposed on them. And she's just saying, like, why is it that liberals will never question, like, governments like Iran saying, hey, this is a double standard, but then they will say, oh, we can't ban the burkini. Like, I just like that she's actually pointing out, like, she does tend to be a little bit more on the liberal side, which I think you can be for freedom of choice without having to be a liberal. And it's actually kind of the reverse, because sometimes liberals are the ones, like these feminist politicians from Sweden who went on a trip to Iran, and they would say they were feminists, but they would never question the Iranian leader saying, well, why do women have to wear the headscarf? Like, if they, not that I'm a feminist, but if you were a true feminist, why didn't you question it? Like, why are you giving them a free pass? I just like that she finally did touch on that at the end of the book, because I thought, you know, that's a good point. We are so afraid, like, and this is not picking on any one religion, but let's say there was a conservative Christian family that told women they had to wear, like, a head covering. Like, there would be liberals that would be questioning that. But if, like, the Iranians, like, impose that on their people, nobody really says anything. And I just like that she was bringing up, well, there are double standards, and maybe we should, like, question those things and not just always be, you know, saying it's okay, you know. And well,
Yeah, from the libertarian point of view, the question is not whether women wear a headscarf or not, but whether a government tells women what they have to do or not.
That's what she said, actually, like what you're saying, but this is the problem. She's coming from it from a liberal perspective, but I think it should be more of a libertarian issue where individuals can choose, not say, oh, well, I'm a liberal, but I don't like how liberals don't stick up for, you know, people, and they support the Iranian government. Like, why do they give them a free pass when here, when they pass like a law saying, oh, you can't wear the burkini, like all the liberals are up in arms about that. But then when there's true, like infractions on liberty in Iran, they will never question the government there. Like, why do we even want to send a diplomatic mission to Iran if they tell women they have to? Not that we are saying that they have to. It's just the fact that people don't have a choice at all, you know?
Yeah. No, I don't really understand the law banning the burkini either. Because, you know, back in the turn of the century, you know, not the turn of the 21st century, everybody's swimsuits were a lot less revealing than they are now.
By the way,
at the time when people did go swimming with really long sleeves and really long, pants.
But it's kind of silly too, because the burkini's not even something like conservative Muslims wouldn't even be at the beach. These women were wearing, it's like a tight bodysuit with like a skirt and a head covering. It's not that.
Okay, but why would anybody have a problem with that? I mean, if they want to wear that.
Why do they care? Like, because the French government was saying it infringes on our secular values. But you know what they did, which was very troubling? There was a woman that was wearing that. And they went over there and they badgered her and made her take it off, and she started crying. And that seems kind of like police intimidation.
What do you mean? They made her take it off with and be naked?
She was wearing it. She was wearing like a tank top underneath, but she was just sitting on the beach. They told her she had to take off like the burkini part, is what I mean. I'm sorry. I should clarify, but that she was like crying. She was in tears.
Okay. Well, I think we shouldn't tell each other what to wear.
Yeah. We shouldn't. Nobody should tell anybody what to wear. I just thought it was, I liked the point that she made that we should just, you know, we should be able to call out their hypocrisy. However, the part I don't really get is why does it always have to come from a liberal perspective, as if liberals are better at this, when that's actually not really the case? Because I follow some other YouTubers that kind of talk about a similar issue, like just people that have kind of question Islam or left it, and they say, well, why is it always from a liberal perspective? Because sometimes liberals don't really respect like freedom of expression all the time.
Not recently they don't. I mean, it just they seem to want to tell us exactly what we can say.
Oh, yeah, that was another thing I was going to bring up, because I don't know, I find Mimsy and Vidu vids, I find their videos very fascinating. So anyway, he was covering this man, because I don't know if you've heard, but it's the 30th anniversary of Salman Rushdie and how he had to go into hiding because of his book, right? Yeah. Do you remember that? So anyway, guess what? Like, he went to Bradford, like somebody went to Bradford, and they were just walking around with his book. And the guy said, you know, I'm actually a Muslim, but I'm questioning like some things because I'm more of a rationalist. And he was walking around with the book, and somebody grabbed the book from him and they set it on fire. And he goes, you know, he even said there were parts of the book that offended me, but like people were taking the book from him because they were offended by it. I guess what I'm trying to say is, why can't we all have our own freedom of expression? Why is it that we're all so keen on censoring each other, you know?
Yeah, yeah, which, you know, I got this weird email, I guess it was from Facebook, letting me know that I shouldn't worry, because anything that is written about vaccines, they're gonna vet it first before it appears on Facebook. And it was just so weird. I don't know why they thought I would be worried about this, but They sent me an email about that.
That's strange. It's kind of like they want everybody to be like, oh, they want you to question something, but you were actually sharing some research. You weren't somebody that was like, oh, I don't know. Like, you actually were just sharing some research. That's strange, but okay. I don't know. I do have some questions about the number of vaccines that the kids have to have, because they're far more than what I had when I was in school. It was quite a few, actually, that my nephew had to have just to be in middle school.
Yeah, no, they've gotten to the point where now you can't graduate from high school without getting an extra meningitis vaccine during your senior year.
I've never even had the meningitis vaccine. Okay.
Yeah, it's a new thing. And at that, you know, sort of had all her other vaccines at that point. I told her, I'm not going to force you to get that. You can decide whether you want to or not. You're practically an adult. And so she went ahead and got it, but otherwise they weren't going to let her graduate.
And, you know, for myself, I'm not like an anti-vaxxer because I've had certain vaccines in my life. But I did have an experience, I remember, when I went to go get a tetanus shot again. And then the lady talked me into getting like a hepatitis, like to start a round of hepatitis vaccinations. And I remember that night I started feeling very panicky and anxious inexplicably. And I don't know, it just kind of made me feel like, that's interesting. So I never finished those. And I don't want to sound like I caught certain vaccinations when I was younger, but just as an adult, I don't really want to get a flu shot, and I don't want to get all these things, because guess what? The flu shot's not even guaranteed to keep you from getting the flu, especially here, by the way. Everybody's getting sick here recently. They're getting some sort of bronchitis, which isn't even the flu. So you could get the flu shot and still be, it's very misleading is my opinion of it all. And if you want to, I think you have the choice to abstain from it.
Right. Yeah, no, I saw, this is something somebody shared. I don't know if it's real or not, but they said they copied it from social media and then just blotted out the name of the person. Mm-hmm. But somebody said, there's this kid in our class and he's not vaccinated and he gave us all the flu. And the reason we know that he's the one who gave us the flu is we all got the flu and he didn't. That's just so crazy.
That isn't that kind of like a witch hunt or defamation?
Right. Exactly. Exactly.
And the thing I hate, okay, I know we're social creatures and people talk about each other, but once again, gossip is a form of, you know, reputation theft. Like, it's, that's damaging his reputation when he didn't do anything wrong. Maybe he just happened to not get the flu and they did, and now they're looking for a scapegoat, and I don't like that. Yeah.
And if they happened to have gotten the flu shot and all of them got the flu and he didn't, you know what he's gonna say.
Actually, you do. Some people end up getting the flu from the flu shot. That's what they don't really want to tell you, is some people end up getting the flu from the flu shot. But you'll see this scary news segment every year about, oh, well, you better get the flu shot because so-and-so got the flu and they nearly died. Like, it's just like they try to scare you into thinking you have to obtain the flu shot. But I never get the flu shot.
Yeah.
But then they also tell you if you don't get the flu shot that you're going to put other people at risk. Like, that's the new thing.
Yeah. Well, how are the unvaccinated putting other people who are vaccinated at risk? That's not how vaccination is supposed to work.
No, it's not. And it just seems like, they're passing some new legislation in California. It's about all this, about where they're going to make it. In California, I think, where you have to vaccinate your kids no matter what.
Well, that's a violation of civil liberties, because you shouldn't have to put anything in your body or into your child's body that you do not choose to put there.
Yeah. Vaccination. Like, I just saw this the other day. I haven't really been following it real much. Three things you need to know about California's proposed mandatory vaccination law. Like, yeah, a lot of people are really upset about it. It's not popular. There's a lot of parents who are very upset. They're saying, how effective is the MMR vaccine for measles, mumps, and rubella? Like, is it even effective? How? And then it's also saying how parents are reacting to potentially losing medical exemptions for vaccinations, or just all the, it's like, it's a lot of people are really upset, but they're basically proposing this legislation here in California at the moment.
Yeah, and the other thing is, I mean, they are giving, they usually do give exemptions to somebody who has been proven to have some kind of medical condition that would make them extremely susceptible. So they don't vaccinate the sickliest children. But sometimes you don't know which child is going to react really badly to vaccine. It's not everybody, but how do you know in advance who it's going to be?
You don't. And if you want to get vaccines, I think that's fine. I mean, I got certain ones when I was younger, but now I don't think I'd want to go get a meningitis vaccine, the flu shot. I certainly don't want to do the round of the hepatitis shots, because the lady told me, well, you should get it because you might get a hepatitis if you eat a Del Taco like we all do. She goes, because you never know. Somebody might not wash their hands if you eat a Del Taco, and you can end up with hepatitis. And that's how she tried to scare me into trying to get. But if you want to get that round of vaccine, that's fine. But I just noticed that night I was feeling kind of, I felt like I was having an adverse reaction to it. But you wouldn't be able to really share that opinion with people in the medical profession, because they would just like kind of poo-poo it and say, oh, no, you're fine.
Yeah. They're not really serving us. They're serving some kind of medical policy. And right now, what they talk about is herd immunity. So they no longer pretend that getting a vaccine, say, against measles or mumps or rubella, is actually going to protect you against measles, mumps, and rubella. They think that all your neighbors have to be vaccinated too before that vaccine can help you. Well, how can you get any kind of immunity if nobody gets any immunity from the vaccine? So
yeah, I think we should still question things. I feel like now what they're telling us is you can't question anything. Just do whatever we recommend. And there could be repercussions in the long term, but they don't want anybody to question anything, which bothers me, because when I was younger, the good teachers I had always said, you should question everything.
Right.
But now they're telling us, just go along with whatever they tell us is correct or the best, and we should just do it. Even though we don't know, 20 years from now, they may say, well, this wasn't such a good idea, because in the 80s they were giving us dietary advice which has been proven unsound now. So how do we know 20 years from now all these vaccines they're recommending, what if new research shows that this could give kids anxiety or there could be other repercussions? I don't know. I just question some of these things sometimes.
Right. And we should definitely be allowed to question them. By the way, do we have any comments, Julia?
You know, I've been looking and I just saw that there were two people watching, but I haven't seen any comments this evening. Did you want to share about any other topics?
I did want to tell everybody that while we were thinking of having a folk sing tonight, it turned out to be a bad night for a lot of the singers. So we're going to have our folk sing with Leslie Fish and Kelly Clear and possibly a few others next Friday instead of this Friday. So that gives you a week to prepare.
Yeah, that's exciting. Oh, by the way, there was one other thing I did want to share. Like, I always thought, what would happen if I just did like a live stream where I played music? So I did. It was just like sharing music I like. Did this pop up on your feed at all, like that live stream I did?
No. Let me check. Let me check on my phone.
I don't think it did, because guess what? The next day I got a notification saying, by the way, your live stream has been blocked in many countries because there was music that was copyrighted, which I guess.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so I guess Well, the only reason this kind of bothers me is because there's some big YouTubers, they'll use like really popular music sometimes on their videos, and they won't receive monetary compensation for that. But it seemed like my video just got blocked pretty much and just fell off the map because there were some 80s songs on that you could hear in the background.
Yeah, well, I think I told you that, I lose monetization. It, even if there's a tiny bit, a snippet of a song in a really long video, like the one Bo's First Christmas. Mm-hmm. You know, so there was some music playing. There was music playing where Sword and her grandmother danced together. And there was some other music. Anyway, they did not make me take down the video, but all of the proceeds from the AdSense on that video are going to the copyright holders of that music. They're making it seem like my contribution to that video was zero.
Wow. Well, at least your video's there.
Yeah.
I went in just to see, is my video even there? And it seems like nobody actually saw it except for when it was live. Maybe somebody saw it. Maybe two people. Yeah. And it kind of bothered me because it's just not there. It's like, it's been blocked. Like, it's just, it doesn't exist at all. Yeah. It's gone.
I check my subscriptions and I have not had anything from you in a while.
That's interesting. Like not even.
Okay. The salad, a vegan.
Salad. Yeah. I did a salad. That yeah, showed up. That was after that. Oh, by the way, it looks like, what was it? The visibility is almost, this video is found to contain, as a result, it's been blocked in some countries and regions. So basically, it had 9 views. It just didn't get any views because it had a song. And I guess I shouldn't have even tried, but I just wanted to see, like, oh, could I do, because some people do live streams where they play music or they play video games and these things are live and they might not receive monetization for that, but it just, it's almost like this video just doesn't exist now.
Yeah, that happened to Austin Peterson too.
Wow.
He was playing some music and they blocked him or something like that.
Yeah, I probably wouldn't try again. I was just kind of curious what would happen, but oh well.
That's a great reason to play only songs that you wrote yourself.
I don't know how to write songs. That's my only problem. Like, if I knew how, I would, but I don't have, like, I would love to have songs like as background music, but I don't know people that write songs for me. So I use some of the ones that are YouTube approved.
Yeah.
But there's a limited number that sounds okay to me. But you're lucky because you know musicians and you have some musical talent yourself. So, like,
yeah, and also you can get away with getting your friends to sing a Disney song, and as long as it's not like sung by a famous person or, you know, in a recording or even the having the accompaniment, you can get away with that. So I got Charla to sing The Circle of Life from The Lion King, and since it's just Charla, she was singing a cappella, mm-hmm. and all that. They did not do anything to me for that.
Oh, good. Well, that's kind of exciting. So yeah, that's good. So were you going to talk a little bit more about like parental influence or anything like in your writing?
Oh, well, you know, I learned a lot of things from my father, but one of the things that I learned is about metrical poetry. And even though my father was a physicist, he learned about metrical poetry from his father. And his father was a philologist and translated metrical poetry from Persian,
ooh,
Hebrew, really? And from Latin to Hebrew, and from Greek to Hebrew. So
Why Persian? Did he live in like, did you have some ancestors that lived there a while back or something? Like, was there just
no? It's just that the Persian literature is classical.
That's true.
He was he studied the classics.
Wow. Yeah, they have some really great classical literature and poetry and Zoroastrian. That's another thing too that we never really talk about. That actually she mentioned in her book, Mashi. She said, you know, like before the Arab conquest, like Persia had Zoroastrianism, like their own religion, like their own culture that was like suppressed. And actually what she said was kind of cool was the Islamic Republic has kind of brought some of that back, like their, like the New Year's celebration and jumping over the fire that comes from like a pre-Islamic tradition. Like some of the ancient traditions are kind of being revived because of like having a like totalitarian state, like people are like wanting to rediscover their roots and Persian literature. Like she talked a little bit about that too.
Well, yeah, I think whenever we try to get around the restrictions of the monotheistic religions, then we kind of go back a little bit and we dig deeper and we find the beauty of the older ancient ways.
There's a lot actually, like, but the Persian, that's interesting. So it sounds like a lot of people in your family, they had day jobs like in the sciences, like, and then at night they were interested in writing and reading metrical poetry. That's pretty interesting. That's pretty neat. Like, how far back does that go in your family?
Well, I guess if you go far enough back, it's just the reading of the Old Testament, which is in itself, you know, it's ancient literature.
Wow. Yeah, that's true. That's really true.
So if you actually read it in depth, then you go past the whatever your rabbi told you is in there and you find out what's really in there, you know?
Yeah, you just read it and you learn. Am I still there?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. You can see me. Okay. My computer screen just went blank for a second. I had to revive it.
Oh, well, it's probably trying to save energy for you.
Yeah, it does that. It's an energy. Actually, the computer screen is an energy-saving TV monitor.
Oh, okay.
Well, because our computer monitor had an issue, so I just turned this TV into, and it's really nice because it's like a high-definition computer screen, so I kind of like it. But it does fall asleep a lot. That's a problem.
Yeah. Yeah, you have to watch out for those things because sometimes they fall asleep, and if the computer falls asleep, then you lose your contact.
Yeah. So what else was it that about like the parental influence, would you say, in your writing?
Oh, well, I guess both my parents are very frugal, and that sort of shows up in my writing. In various places.
Yeah, I like that because they make it seem like, oh, anybody who's for being a libertarian and wanting to have like a sound budget, like somehow, oh, they must be really rich, but maybe that's not the case. Maybe they just had to work very hard for the money they earned and they wanted to make sure that the money they earned was used wisely. Like, I like that, you know?
Yeah, yeah, you know, right now I'm hearing a lot of arguments about Obamacare again, the Affordable Care Act.
Oh, yeah, it's coming up again, right?
Yeah, it's coming up again. And I guess in a way, on Facebook, since I don't get offended easily, I get to see the arguments that are made by different people that I may not agree with. So I saw this one person who really likes the Affordable Care Act and feels that she might lose her medical insurance if it were, you know, done away with, and specifically the part about pre-existing conditions. And what's interesting is I saw this sort of straw man argument that she used to justify her feelings about it. She said, of course, the people, the Trump supporters, and of course she assumes that if somebody's against the Affordable Care Act, they have to be, you know, big fan of Donald Trump.
But which is probably far from the truth, actually.
Yeah. Actually, Donald Trump is kind of for socialized medicine, and he had a plan of his own. So it's not that at all. But anyway, she was imagining the person who doesn't want the Affordable Care Act would be a very traditionalist kind of possibly maybe evangelical Christian. And she was thinking, well, that person would probably think that disease is a punishment from God. And that's why we shouldn't have insurance take care of people or something like that. And of course, that is such a straw man. That's not what...
It's a straw man argument. You know, even back when I was more of a liberal, I never liked that. Like, I always felt like the liberals were always looking for somebody that they had to put in their box. I don't know. But then you couldn't put them in a box. And I don't like that, you know. Why do we have to have like mandatory health insurance anyway?
Well, here's the thing. We do have runaway costs with health insurance. Mm-hmm. And this person was saying that she ran through, I don't know, $3 million during her first year of illness, something like that. Anyway, the problem there, and it is a problem, is why does it cost so much?
It shouldn't cost that much. Like,
So she said she basically ran all through her coverage, and that would be the end of it. But if there were no insurance, and certainly not a deep pocket insurance for everybody, then the costs could not possibly skyrocket to that amount, because nobody would pay it.
No, they wouldn't. And I just think that it's being inflated maybe because of supply and demand. Like, maybe if we had more physician's assistants who do a lot of the same things as doctors, that could make, just if we had more healthcare providers, maybe it's the fact that everybody, I just feel like there's a better answer to the health insurance crisis than what we're being provided is all, you know?
Right, because what's really going to happen is, I mean, these are amounts that most people do not see in their entire lifetimes. But it doesn't make sense that to keep somebody alive would take more money than that person could ever possibly earn. Most physicians, if they were actually in a free market, would know they couldn't charge that much to anybody.
Yeah, definitely. So,
because the money doesn't exist. So
it's just conflated and it's a mess.
Yeah. And it's if we continue this way, 100% of the gross national product will go into healthcare and we won't have money for food. I mean, how is that going to work?
It's not going to work. And it's kind of a problem. And I feel like, too, like, I understand you definitely need to go to the doctor if you get sick. But I also feel like they kind of push that, oh, you need to go to the doctor no matter what, like, all the time for, like, everything. Like, there are people that really push that. And it used to be that was considered, like, being a hypochondriac. Like, do you know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
But now, like, they're saying, you need to go to the doctor no matter what. You need to be tested for everything to see if you have a deficiency for anything. I'm like, really? What if you feel okay? What if you're not sick? What if you're healthy generally? Then I need to go to the doctor all the time?
Right. And some of these tests are actually bad for you. So they've been pushing mammograms on women. And then it turns out the mammograms actually can cause cancer.
Yeah, they can. And I don't. What if you just don't want to have that test? Are you really hurting anybody? And if they think that it's going to, maybe it's okay to abstain from it. I think, like, just my opinion. You don't have to. If other people want to do it, they can. But I don't think anybody should be
Well, nobody should be forced to, but I mean, if we're all forced to pay for everybody's insurance, we're all also going to be forced to undergo all sorts of testing. So, because they say that preventative care is always the best. See what I'm saying?
No, I see what you're saying, but I think they push too much of the preventative care. And I think it still goes back to this big thing that there's a pharmaceutical profit to it. Not that I'm all for the free market economy, but there's something that drives it, right? And right. It's because there's a certain market that would be really happy to have socialized medicine. So I think a lot of what was behind the curtain that we never saw was, oh, probably a lot of the drug industry was a big supporter of Obamacare back at the time, which is what I didn't really think about back then. Yeah. But I bet you they are, and I bet you they love it, you know?
Yeah, right. So I do hope that somehow Facebook also allows those people to see this kind of discussion and realize, wow, not everybody who is against the Affordable Care Act is number one, rich, or number two, a crazy, evangelist.
We're not evangelists, neither you nor I, and we're not like super millionaires flying off.
No, we're not.
I think that's, I have questions about it, because I honestly, just from the standpoint, what if you just generally don't want to go to the doctor all the time and you generally feel that there are like just healthy living can sometimes be a better alternative to always seeking medical treatment for everything? That's my concern about like in mandatory health insurance. I understand sometimes people need to go to the doctor if they have like a true medical condition, but this whole pushing a preventative medicine kind of bothers me. Well, here's a point and an example. Preventative dental care. Do you know what that is?
Well, do you mean like fluoridation?
Well, that's part of it. But I think back to this experience I had with this dentist, and he kept telling my mom, we're preventative. But they wanted me to go to the dentist every 2 months to get a cleaning, like a dental cleaning. And the lady was scraping my gums and making them bleed, like with the scalpel, you know, all the tools, and my gums were bleeding. And she kept saying, it's because you're not flossy enough. You're not flossy enough. And they were doing this, I found out at the end, because they told me, oh, your mom has really good insurance, like, so it covers a lot, and other people can't get all these procedures done, but we get a lot from the insurance. And I'm like, oh, okay. And that was the day that the dentist cut my lip when he was doing like the filling. So I was like, I'm never going back there again. That was fun. But yeah, they were so preventative that I didn't see the dentist in almost 3 years. And then he got mad at me because I had a cavity. But I saw the dental hygienist every 2 months. But they didn't do any x-rays in like 3 years. I didn't see the dentist in that time period. But then he gave me a lecture, because when I finally did see him after 3 years, he said, oh, you have a cavity.
Wow.
So I don't know, like sometimes preventative, I'm not saying all preventative medicine is bad, but sometimes I think it might not always be the best thing.
I remember one time when I was a child and we were living in Grand Prairie, Texas, and the dentist was trying to scare me and my mother. He was showing us pictures of microbes. You know, he had like a picture, through a microscope or whatever. And these were microbes that were supposedly in my mouth or whatever. And he said, you see, it's so dirty in there. There are all these creatures. And my mother looked at it and she said, do you think that we're primitives? Do you think we don't know that there are living things in our mouth?
Of course, like everybody has. There are good germs and there's bad germs. There is a bias. They must think anybody would just fall for it and be like, oh my gosh, I need more dental appointments. Like,
right. So yeah, there's a lot of that going on.
And I'm not saying don't go to the doctor if you're sick. I'm not saying don't ever seek like medical advice, but I do feel that this push for mandatory health insurance is just kind of like, they don't want anybody. Well, like if you're into more just wanting to maybe eat things that make you feel good, like, you know, because you said that there's ways that you feel that you eat that can make you feel healthy. Like, they don't want you to seek out other, well, for instance, diabetic. Like, some doctors will tell somebody if they're type 2 diabetic that they can never reverse it, no matter what they do, and they have to stay on medication for the rest of their life. But that's actually not true. You can reverse it by eating less sugar and changing your diet. And people do, and people have, but there are some doctors that told people they'd have to be on medication for the rest of their life and they could never reverse it. And that's not true. And that kind of bothered me, you know, because I started Googling that for just somebody who told me that, and I figured out right away, actually, there are doctors who say you can reverse it by changing how you eat.
Yeah. And that's where going low carb can help.
Yeah, definitely. And I think that there's a lot of interest in those diets right now. So why... That's all I'm trying to say.
Right. Yeah. And there are a lot of things we don't know. There are things the doctors themselves don't know. And it's okay to have an open mind and to talk to more than one expert, but not necessarily take their advice if you don't think that they have the answer.
Yeah, I think it's okay to seek other advice or to just wait it out, or I don't know. Well, I do know. I just think that we're becoming a little bit micromanaging. It's like they do want everybody to do the same thing, even when that could be flawed and they could make a mistake.
Right. And the thing is, one of the things they do is they use statistics to frighten you by telling you, here's 99% of the people are like this. And if you're not like this, then there's something wrong with you. You know, I mean, even when you go for your well baby checkup and they will tell you what percentile your child is in. Well, every child, you know, in terms of how tall they are and how much they weigh and all of that, well, every child is going to develop a little bit differently. And you can't expect your child to be, you know, like the average child, or even if they are born, you know, in the 99 percentile in weight, if they're not going to be a very tall person, eventually they won't remain in the 99% percentile in weight unless they're going to be obese, you know?
I know, like, and that's a bit, I think a new mother would probably, that doesn't have as much background or education, would probably be intimidated by one of those doctor's appointments, whereas someone who's educated like yourself, you could kind of reason through all that. But I feel bad for like a younger parent. How would they deal with that information? It might make them confused because what if you're only going to ever be 5'2 or 5'3? A lot of people don't get much taller than that.
Yeah. Right. And the thing is, if your baby's born very healthy, you know, there's some who are premature and all that. But if your child is born full term and is weighing a reasonable amount, they're not, you know, that part of it is one thing. And then how much they grow as time passes is another thing. And it has a lot to do with your genetic background. So,
yeah, it has very much to do with your genetic background. Like, it's your height, I mean, can change a little bit. I know, like, people eating more variety of foods on a Western diet, like in Japan, they're, men became taller because they started eating a larger variety of foods. However, in my background, the women weren't that tall and neither were the men. So I was only ever going to be 5'3". I wasn't supposed to be taller than that. But, you know, it bothered my parents because I was shorter than both of my parents. But I was the same height as all my aunts. And I was the same height as my great-grandmother. So that was my genetic
being. Right.
I don't know.
Yeah, so my daughter and I are relatively short, and that's okay.
I actually like it. Like, I don't know. I think it's kind of cool, like, because I feel like there's a lot of people that are taller than, I'm shorter than what they consider the average U.S. height, and I kind of like it.
Yeah, we're below average too, but then I've got a nephew who's very tall, so.
That's pretty cool, yeah. My nephew's very tall as well, actually. Some of them are. It's interesting. But anyway.
Yeah. So everybody's got a different background. And I think I told you that for instance, jaundice at a certain age, you know, just very shortly for a newborn, is not that unusual if you have an Asian background.
Yes, exactly. But you didn't even, like, you learned that from, like, reading a pamphlet in Taiwan, right? Or
right.
Something.
Yes, that's right.
Whereas if you had been going to a pediatrician here, they might not have known that, you know?
Well, I was actually lucky enough to, before we left the United States to go back to Taiwan, I was lucky enough to have a pediatrician see my daughter who was herself Indian, you know, from India. So when she saw that my daughter was a little bit jaundiced at exactly that age, she didn't freak out about it. But when something like that happened to my brother years earlier, the doctors didn't realize that that was perhaps normal, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Well, and I was a little bit jaundiced too when I was young, and a little bit too, like, this thing called, like, melasma. Like, I just get some brown spots. It's like a Mediterranean thing, like East Mediterranean. It's just something I wondered what it was, and I read that that's what it is, you know?
Okay. Yeah. You know, there are a lot of things that we could be diagnosed with an illness when it could be perfectly normal for our particular ethnicity at that point in time.
Yeah, it is. It makes sense when you do a little bit of your own research, but if you just went with whatever the first doctor said without getting a second opinion or doing some research, knowing a little bit about your background, then you might not get down to what the truth was about certain things, in my opinion.
Right. So the whole idea that we should rely on statistics when we've got an ethnically diverse population and our statistics take into account everybody, that doesn't even make any sense.
No, it doesn't, for surely not.
So that's another problem that we have with our current medical establishment.
I guess we could, I mean, you could probably discuss this for weeks. Like, there's just so many issues. It's a very deep topic.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I guess it's about time to sign off. But
yeah, we're getting pretty late. I didn't realize
that. But I enjoyed the conversation.
Yeah, it was interesting. I was glad we got to hear more about your books, and maybe people can check them out, you know?
Yeah, and you know what? We're going to have to figure out some other way to get music on your channel.
I don't know. Like, I kind of have given up because that was a disappointment. So I'll figure something out maybe someday. I don't know. We'll see.
Well, we could always ask Leslie Fish or Kelly Clear to sing whatever song you want.
Oh. And,
even though we don't hold the copyright to the 80s songs, they might not notice because it's not a standardized recording.
You know, I just want a kind of fun song that I could sometimes use maybe on a video. It doesn't even have to be an 80s song. I just want something upbeat, if that makes any sense.
Uh-huh. Okay, well, we can probably arrange that.
Oh, thank you. I'm excited, but it was really interesting having this conversation with you, Aya.
Okay, well, you have a wonderful evening, Julia.
Okay. Have a good night.
Good night. Bye.